So we are moving on to verse number 6 this morning in 1 Timothy 3. Getting down to the wire, we've got this verse in verse 7, and we will be done with the office of a bishop or an elder or a pastor as we've been going through these qualifications. And immediately following that, we have the qualifications of a deacon as we've been looking at church offices. Now, this will be our 24th week on that. How about that? So not a novice. Verse number 6 says, not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. He fall into the condemnation of the devil. This man, if he is worthy of the ministry, it must be clear that this guy's not a flash in the pan, right? Excitement for a season, but then it soon dwindles out, because the ministry is a lifelong calling, right? Ministry, being called to the ministry is a lifelong calling. I might choose to make pizzas for a few years, give that a shot. Brother Eric gave that a shot for a little while, and I might decide, you know what, this ain't my thing, right? I'd rather not do this and move on to something else. I changed my major when I was in college. That's all well and good, but that's not the case with this, right? This isn't something you try out for a time and then you decide this isn't for me and walk away from it. This guy must not be a novice. It's not something you take a shot at and decide a few years later it's not for you. How did Jesus put it in Luke 9 and verse number 62? Let's look at Luke 9 and verse number 62. And I want you to see in the context of this, this is not simply for the one that is called to ministry, not simply for the one that is a pastor or an elder. This actually applies to all those that profess the Lord Jesus Christ. But as we've said, with all of these characteristics, these are things that the church should desire as a whole. But this man is exemplary in these areas. And so in Luke 9 and verse number 62, actually we only saw one characteristic that is not necessarily applying to all, and it has to do with the gift and God giving this man the ability to teach. But everything else we said, these are qualifications. These are just the characteristics of the children of God that this man is exemplary in. So in Luke 9 and in verse number 61, this individual comes up to Christ and says, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell which are at my home and at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. This applies to every professing Christian, right? Because as his sheep, we're all called to do what? Follow him, right? This should be the cry of the heart of every believer. Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go. Wherever you say go, that's what I will do. Well, I want to be obedient to that. I've told you guys before, the reason that we came up here for me to go to school in Atlanta, Georgia, is because the gospel was here. Because I wanted to raise my family under the truth, and I'm looking out there and I'm not seeing a lot of truth. And so when you know that here's the truth, you go where God says go. You go where God says his word is. You go where God has called you to. And so I'll follow you, Lord, wherever you go. And Jesus doesn't say, great, let me sign you up. Come on, let's go. He says, I want you to understand this. Whoever follows me must be an individual that keeps his hand on the plow looking forward, not looking back. In other words, this is a man that remembers Lot's wife. Remember Jesus saying that? Little three-word verse in the scripture. Remember Lot's wife. She had clean escaped. She was out of Sodom physically, but her heart never left, right? And so she looks back and she's destroyed, even though physically she had escaped. This man is not one that puts his hand to the plow and looks back. This is not a role for one with that type of attitude and behavior. This is an individual that remembers Lot's wife. Now, I want us to see this word novice, and I want us to understand its meaning. It's made up of two root words. One of the root words simply means new. It's just new. You look it up something that's new, right? You got a new car. No one's had that one before. It means new. The second word, I want to show it to you in Luke 8 because it really drives home the meaning behind this word. What does it mean to not be a novice? Not a novice. In Luke 8 and in verse number 6, as Jesus is telling this parable here of the sower and the seed that's scattered and the various types of soil that it falls upon, the result of that planting. In verse number 6, we read about a group that it says, some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. Now, the phrase here, as soon as it was sprung up, is the other root word. So novice in 1 Timothy 3:6 means newly sprung up. That's what it's talking about. That's literally what it means, newly sprung up. You need to make sure that this man doesn't have sprung up faith. Sprung up only faith, right? It's just he showed that exciting evidence to start with, and it comes quickly out of the ground. In fact, the idea here is that this one shoots up quicker and taller than the rest of the plantings because there's not any soil, so it has, I mean, it's just rocky, you know, so it has nowhere to go except up. So it looks great to start with, but because there is no root, because it's not in Jesus Christ who is the root, the branch isn't attached there, then in very little time, this plant withers away. There's nothing wrong with simply the springing up part, and I want you to see that. Let's read on a little further. There's one that falls among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And other fell on good ground and did what? Sprang up. It's the same. That's the same Greek word. So they've all sprung up here, but the issue is with the endurance, right? The issue is whether or not they produce fruit. This one sprang up and bare fruit and hundredfold. And when he had said these things, he cried, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." So the problem is not simply the springing up. The concern is that if this plant is newly sprung up, right? We got to get that other word with it as well. We don't know if he's fit for the ministry if he's newly sprung up. This man needs to be verified as a fruit-bearing plant. As a fruit-bearing plant. Now here's the problem. You're not going to know this except you observe this individual for a while, right? This individual needs to be observed for a while. This place of leadership is not for one with a new profession. The church needs to see a prolonged walk of obedience. See, only a mature plant produces fruit. Some of you know we were battling the rains and the cold up in North Georgia recently. We had the McGrews there and the Pettingers and part of the Feathers and part of the Ludex and this other family that I enjoyed, the Pettingers know, enjoyed getting to know and spending some time with in the Lord. But we also had some cold weather and some rain. And I found out something, that our tent is not a winter tent. It's made for summer dwelling. But we had a good time nonetheless. But one of the things we did while we were up there in apple country is we went and we picked apples. And so I was curious, how long does it take these apple trees to produce apples? Well, I looked it up and it says usually 2 to 5 years, sometimes longer, but 2 to 5 years. In other words, the plant doesn't just spring up in the middle immediately, whoop, you know, here are all the apples. It doesn't spring up with all this fruit. It takes some time. It takes some maturity before the fruit is produced. God made it that way. And part of the reason he made it that way was to teach us about this right here. This man is not to be newly sprung up. The newly sprung up ones don't show that evidence of fruit. It takes some time. And we know the parable of the fig tree full of leaves, and it looks like it's a great tree, you know, but there's not any fruit when the Lord comes to it. So you're going to have to observe this man for a time to see that there is evidence of fruit. You don't see the fullness of this evidence overnight. That doesn't mean we discourage anybody, right? You receive someone upon their profession of faith. You tell me you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, guess what I'm going to do? It's good to meet you, brother. It's good to meet you, sister, right? I'm going to trust you at your word, but you don't throw a person in leadership without observing that there has been some fruit upon that tree, that the fruits of the Spirit are evident in that life. All of these qualities that we've looked at before, We get down here to this, and it's really referencing back to everything that we've seen before. There's no way that you're going to know that this man is blameless, right? All of these things, as we went down through there and we saw this pattern of this man's life, we're not going to know that overnight. This is something that happens as you observe this individual for a time. You can't tell if he's a novice. You won't be able to tell whether or not all these previous things are a pattern in this man's life. Now, I want to be clear about this. Novice has nothing to do with the man's natural age. It's not related to that at all. That's not what newly sprung up has to do with. Doesn't mean that he can't be a young man. Guess what Timothy was compared to Paul? A young man. Did you know even when Paul is there at the very end of his life, 2 Timothy is his last letter as far as we can tell. I fought a good fight. He's talking about the fight in the past tense. And guess what he writes to Timothy? Flee youthful lust. Timothy, no matter how old you get, you're still a youth to me. You're still a young man to me, right? So Timothy was a young man to Paul, and even at the very end of his life, he is warning Timothy to flee youthful lust. And I want you to see in 1 Timothy chapter 4 what he says to Timothy here. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, so this is an earlier letter, and we see that Timothy was a young man. And look at what he admonishes, how he admonishes Timothy here in 1 Timothy 4 and in verse number 12. Let no man despise thy what?
Youth.
Let no man despise thy youth. You're a young man, Timothy. Don't let that work against you in the ministry, right? He admonishes him to make sure he guards against youthful things that might cause offense. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believer. Doesn't matter what your age is, you can still be an example to the believers, and you ought to do that in word, in your manner of life, in conversation, in charity. The love of Christ should be evident of you, in Spirit of God, the fruits of the Spirit evident in you, in faith, a steadfast belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, in purity, and you keeping your body under that blamelessness that we talked about at the very beginning. What did we say blameless meant? We said it meant not, in the words escaping me now, what was it? Not seized, right? Blameless. Not seized by any but Christ. So Timothy was a young man, but yet he was one that was fit for the ministry. He was one that was not a novice in the faith. I want you to also, I came across this verse and I thought it was good. 1 Corinthians 16. And here's the flip side of that. So even as Paul admonished Timothy, don't let that youth be a hindrance and let anyone despise you because of that youth. Here he writes to the Corinthians and says, hey, don't despise this young man, but receive him. He similarly admonishes the church in 1 Corinthians 16. And I wanted you to see how that read in verse number 10. Now, if Timotheus come, see that he may be with you without fear. Listen to what Paul says is, for he worketh the work of the Lord as I also do. It doesn't matter that he's a young man and I'm his elder. You know what? We're doing the same work of the Lord for the profit of you all. Let no man therefore despise him. Timothy, let no man despise you because of your youth. Corinthian church, don't despise this man because of his youth. But conduct him forth in peace that he may come unto me, for I look for him with the brethren. So he writes to the Corinthian church, receive this young man and don't reject him on the basis of any seeming difference with Paul. Like, for example, his youthfulness, because you know what? Timothy was every much one performing the work of the Lord as the elder Paul was. We're laborers together. And so he admonishes them on both sides there. To that point, younger generation, let me tell you what you need to do. You need to take full advantage of the wisdom of the older generation. Take full advantage of those that have walked in the Lord longer than you have. They've got some bumps on their arm, some dents in their armor, right? Some dents in their shield that had labored long in the faith. Take full advantage of their instruction. Respect them. And you know what? You younger generation need to encourage the younger generation to finish strong. We've got example of after example in the scripture of men that were doing great, it seemed like, until the end of their life, and then they just fall apart. Was it Uzziah that goes there at the end and contracts the leprosy, right, brother, at the end of his life? We know about Solomon. You know, it starts off great, and then he multiplies wives, and his heart is turned away from the Lord. Encourage them to finish strong. They ought to be encouraged by your example. He wrote that to Timothy. Timothy, you're a young man, but you ought to be encouraging those that God has put you among to minister to them. And then also, older generation, encourage these younger ones, right? Knowing that, guess what? One day you're not going to be here, and they're going to have to carry on. So instruct them in love and care for their souls and desire that they continue on strong and faithfully carry on in that hour. Yes, listen, we're in a day of abounding iniquity. And the danger for every heart is that love grows cold. We need to encourage one another and not let any of these things be barriers to our fellowship with each other. So not a novice. It doesn't have to do with age, natural age here. It has to do with spiritual age, right? Not a novice doesn't mean that he must have more experiences in his natural life. That's not what that's about. Listen, if as a pastor, if you got to have natural experiences that other people are going through in order to minister to them, listen, I'm totally messed up when a woman gets pregnant in my church, right? How am I as a man? I don't pass the physical, right? How am I going to minister to that pregnant woman? How could Paul, who was never married, give instruction on marriage? It wasn't because he had that natural experience. It was because he had spiritual experience. Because Paul was, in fact, married, right? He was part of the bride of Jesus Christ. And so he could minister to those individuals and give them instruction, good instruction, concerning marriage because he was part of the bride of Christ. And so I want to show you 1 Timothy 4. I thought this was good also. Paul writes to Timothy here, this young man, that he's just told, let no one despise your youth in verse number 12. Listen to what Paul tells him is the key to his ministry, to an effectual ministry. It really kind of starts back up at right after that verse where he says, let no man despise thy youth, and including that verse. Verse 13 says, till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Listen, Timothy, as you walk in obedience to that which God has revealed to you through His Word, as you walk in obedience and you immerse yourself in the Word of God and prayer and study and meditation upon His Word, continuing in them, what will the result be? For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear. Paul said, it doesn't matter what your age is and what your lack of natural experiences are, you're able to minister by the Spirit of God as you walk in obedience and remain in the Word of God, the study of God's Word, the meditation upon God's Word, the crying out to God and seeking Him. God will direct you by His Spirit to be able to be an able minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the issue here is a youngness in the faith, right? When it says not a novice. This newly sprung up is one that is young in the faith. There's no set number of years given. God doesn't say observe them for this long. We can look at some things in Scripture and we can say, well, you know, Jesus taught the disciples for 3 years in His earthly ministry before He leaves and turns over that leadership to them in His church. So it had been several years that they were instructed by the Lord. The Apostle Paul, we know Galatians tells us he was 3 years separated from learning and laboring in the Lord. And when he comes to Jerusalem, go over and read it. Write these down real quick if you've got a pen. So he was 3 years before he went up to Jerusalem, he said, after his salvation. That's what Galatians 1:18 tells us. In Acts 9:27, we see him coming to Jerusalem, and the church didn't want to receive him, but Barnabas spoke on his behalf and told them the way that God had been using Saul. But you know what? That's Acts 9. It's still several chapters later in chapter 13, verses 2 and 3, before we read that the Spirit separated Saul and Barnabas. It said that he separated them for the work which I have called them. And so it was at that time that they laid their hands on them and sent them out. So it was several years after Paul's conversion before the church, before they lay their hands on them and send them out in the ministry as directed by the Spirit of God. And so that laying on of hands, that we ought to read 1 Timothy 5 while we're here, because this goes along very well with our topic of not being a novice. It says, lay, this is 5:22, lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. Now that, not by mistake, that verse right there follows up on all this instruction concerning elders in the previous verses. Verse 17, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in the word and doctrine. For the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his hire, of his reward. Against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses, them that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear. Charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that thou observe these things without preferring one before another. That sounds like the beginning of the Corinthian letter. You say you're of Apollos or Paul, but we ought to all be of Christ, doing nothing by partiality. And then he better not be a novice, right? You're setting yourself up for trouble. Lay hands suddenly on no man. You can't know that this man will stand faithful in the ministry except you observe him for a time. He must not be a novice. We're running out of time. There is similar instruction in Titus 1, verse number 9. That's the Titus account of the qualifications of an elder. And there he says this man needs to be one that is holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught. You cannot know that a novice will hold fast. This man must be observed for a time to know this. Now, as we close, what does our verse reveal is the great danger for the novice? What's the great danger there? Lest being lifted up with pride, right? He fall into the condemnation of the devil. Pride is the danger. It's like we've seen with these young movie stars over and over again through the years. They enter into this early, and you know what? All of a sudden, they're in the spotlight, right? And they have this fame, and they have this influence. And what happens? We see it again and again, right? They can't take it. They can't handle in this lack of experience, this attention and this and the spotlight there. Well, there is a similar danger here in the ministry, because a man with little experience in walking with the Lord, if he's all of a sudden in a place of leadership and influence over other men's souls, this can be a very, very dangerous thing as it pertains to pride. This individual will read, remember that verse in Hebrews 13:7 that says, obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. It's talking about those that preach the word of God to you. He'll read just the first part of that verse, and he won't read the next part that says, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account. He'll look at just the first part and says, look at who I am and look at the response and the influence that I have and the responsibility that I have, but not understand that he's a servant to their souls. He is in a place of leadership in order to serve, and he must give an account for that. What was the devil's downfall? Let's close with Ezekiel 28 and verse number 14, and we'll see it. We'll see this condemnation of the devil. Ezekiel 28 and in verse number 14. Guess why God created the angels? Hebrews 1:14 says that they are ministering spirits to those that are heirs of salvation. They were made to serve. Satan wouldn't have that. Ezekiel 28 and verse number 14. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. Now, we don't know how long after the devil's creation that the fall came, but our text to me regarding the novice and he might fall into the pride, the condemnation of the devil suggests that it wasn't very long. It wasn't very long before this iniquity was found in him. But I want you to see something. There was no lack in that which God had done. Satan was well equipped for his responsibility in serving God and glorifying God. So there was no lack of ability. And we've said this before concerning the man. Just because he's got ability to teach, we're not there yet, right? That was one little short part of all the qualifications that we look at. Ability to teach. So there's not a lack of ability here, but what's the problem in verse number 17? Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. The issue was pride. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. The call to ministry is a call to serve. And Satan was created to serve man, but Satan didn't want to serve. Satan wanted to be sir. This man needs to be observed to make sure he's not a novice and that he's got a heart for service to serve others, not a heart to be served himself. Amen.